So hello, I'm Nikita Mazarov. I'm a new postdoc here at the Living Archives Project, and I've recently just completed my PhD in goldsmiths and cultural studies. And what I've been looking at in the past is kind of how to share information, and broadly interpreted, that usually expresses itself as how do people prevent you from sharing information, and then how can you then share it if people are just trying to stop you. And so a large part of my existing practice has been looking at contesting intellectual property. So what does it mean, for instance, not just for copyright, but also for things like copyleft to actually impede the unbridled dissemination of information? And it was a practice-based PhD, so specifically I looked at how to remove potential watermarks in academic journal articles or in cinema or in ebooks, and in that way so that those who share the particular bits of information can then not be stopped from sharing in the future. So in other words, how do we facilitate long-term sharing by kind of ensuring user privacy and basically supporting those people who choose to share materials with us? How can we make sure they continue to share? And so I've developed kind of a critical praxis around both actually setting up frameworks for sharing and kind of the underlying theory behind it, which was predominantly based on kind of 19th century Sternerian illegalism blended with kind of 21st century post-humanism along the lines of Braidotti and the likes. So that's kind of what I've done in the past. What I'm excited about doing now in the Living Archive is basically, the way that I conceptualize an archive is through the pivotal principle of unreliability. So what does it mean for an archive to be unreliable? And why is this important? The reason that unreliability is important is precisely to protect the anonymity of those who contribute to the archive so that they can continue to contribute to that archive. So in other words, if let's say you have a so-called shadow library consisting of various books, and someone submits a book to the archive, and let's say the publisher is not happy that that book has been submitted to the archive, and they want to find out who actually submitted that book so that they can then file legal proceeding against them and make sure that they don't share the book again. They can likely do that by embedding metadata into that ebook. So let's say that if you purchased it from Amazon, and Amazon puts in a unique ID into the book, they can then trace who uploaded the book to that particular archive and then file legal proceedings against them and then neutralize the source. Okay, so what my research then will look at is how do we make that data unreliable? In other words, how do we make it not link back to the person who shared the object? And the way that we explore that is both through looking at metadata as well as various practices around the text. For instance, not uploading something at the exact same time that you purchased it, because those are known as time correlation attacks, and so forth. And so the way that I basically conceptualize of the archive is something that needs protection. In other words, the archivists themselves need protection to ensure the longevity of the archive themselves. Right, so what I have with me today is this literal black box. So, you know, oftentimes when we talk about digital archives and so on, there's kind of a prescient immateriality or a lack of a physicality associated with it, right? When we upload documents to the cloud, we just kind of think that, oh, they go somewhere in this nebulous sphere without any kind of physical relation. But actually, it all comes back to data storage. And so this simple hard drive can store, you know, thousands of actual digitally archived documents. So on the one hand, we have kind of this vast compression of information into a tightly confined material space, but at the same time, that then leads to an escalation of the security implications as well, where if we have 1,000 different ebooks on here, that in turn means that there's potentially 1,000 different ways of being identified and the archive being neutralized. So the black box, in other words, is effective in the high compression of data, but it's also highly dangerous, right? In that if you have, let's say, 10,000 journal articles and you forget to remove metadata from just one out of those 10,000, the entire collection will potentially be compromised by revealing the identity of the contributor to the archive. And so a large portion of my work then is how do we protect the contributors? And what I plan to be doing is actually developing a toolkit to remove metadata, to remove other kinds of forensic markers embedded in content that's contributed to the archive, so as to protect those who contribute to the archive, and in turn, thus protect the longevity of the archive itself. So in other words, how can we make sure that this little black box actually continues to exist in the wild, not in police headquarters?